wants to hear it. Thank you for the prayer. And we're in Ezekiel chapter 28 today. What an incredible book. I spent a lot of time studying this. I spent a lot of time studying because I don't know anything. So I have to learn a lot of things. I don't want to back up too much. Sometimes when you back up, you don't have time to do whatever you're supposed to do. But, we're beginning, we're in 28 today, chapter 28. So let me just say this, that all the way through, 25. Let's see, 25 is when it starts. So chapters 1 all the way to, 23. There we go. All that's about the fall of Jerusalem. First of all, the first chapter is about the call of Ezekiel, how God came to him and manifested his glory to Ezekiel. Ezekiel is more about the glory of God than probably any other book. It's just the manifestation of the glory of God. How that was manifested to Ezekiel, left him without strength in his body, completely unable to speak until the Lord strengthened him so he could speak. But so all of this was about the fall of Jerusalem and then the hope of restoration. And then when we get to the passage that we're into today, you have the judgment of the nations. That's chapter 25 through 32. Okay. And so this is going to be the nations are going to be judged by God. That means that they're going to be thrown down, the nations, all right? So over here is Judah or Israel, all about Israel going down, but then the promise that they'll come back up. And, of course, they did, because after 70 years of captivity in Babylon, they were able to go back into the land, rebuild the temple. But then there's a far-reaching, you always keep that in mind, there's a far-reaching development of fulfillment of prophecy. There was a near fulfillment, like they get to go back, but there's a fulfillment, and that would be the coming of Jesus Christ back to the earth. And the restoration of Israel at that time. Israel will be restored at the second advent of Jesus Christ. What they did in 1948 is not the restoration of Israel. In fact, they're probably going to be destroyed again before he comes. Probably during the tribulation. There's no question about it during the tribulation. What they got over there today in Israel, it's going to be destroyed. And the temple, if they build a temple, it's going to be evil. It's not going to be what God builds. Can you imagine that maybe Satan would build a temple in Jerusalem and yeah, and offer animal sacrifices? Yeah, that may happen. All right, and then the last part is chapter 38 through 48. 10 chapters are devoted to the kingdom of God that's coming on the earth. Like I said, that's the coming kingdom of God. And it's all about the glory. The glory of God now in this last few chapters, which we may not have a chance to go through all of it. Of course we don't. But it's going to be the manifestation of the glory of God on the earth for the first time ever. It'll be the kingdom of God on earth. All that the preaching of Jesus when he was on the earth was all about that, the kingdom of God. The Bible from the very beginning going through. Remember in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 11, he said the prophets, all the prophets could look down on this mountain and they could see two things. You remember that? That's how we understand it. They could see the suffering. This is 1 Peter. This is an incredible passage to understand the Bible. It's one of the keys to understanding the Bible right there. There's a number of keys. The biggest key for understanding the scriptures is don't ever get it mixed up that Israel is the church or that church is Israel. You get those mixed up and you're going to just be an idiot in terms of the scripture forever. Israel remains over here. The church remains over here. In fact, here's the church. meaning that not, and the word church used many different ways, but the church, which is the body of Christ. We do have to define it, the body of Christ. The church, which is the body of Christ, was never known to the prophets. They couldn't see it. That's why Paul called it a mystery, the mysterion, a mystery. But what all the prophets saw, all of them, including Ezekiel, all the rest of them, the minor prophets, the major prophets, they saw two things. They saw suffering, they saw a suffering servant, and they saw a coming king, a coming king. And so basically they saw the suffering, and then he tells us right there, they saw the glory that was to follow. The suffering and the glory that was to follow. The cross and then the crown. See that? And that's a key to understanding the scriptures, especially the Old Testament. All of the Old Testament prophets are going to include these things because that's the plan of God. For instance, there is no glory, there is no crown without the cross, right? There's no crown without the cross. And so what comes first? This comes first, the suffering servant, and then the coming king. And so we know that what's been fulfilled on the earth. This has been fulfilled on the earth. Jesus has come. This is called the first advent. What is this called? The second advent. And prior to the second advent, this is Christ coming back and manifesting this glory, and this kingdom is to be set up. Here's the kingdom. And there's a 1,000-year reign according to Revelation. Right before that, his second advent is a dark time called the tribulation. Matthew 24 is all about the tribulation. And so it's a tribulation, it's a dark time. It's a day of gloom, it's a day of judgment. It's a day of God's wrath falling upon the earth and upon the nations of the earth. And in fact, these scriptures here, including the one we're studying this morning, that they're going to be fulfilled during the tribulation. They're fulfilled in the short term, you know, right here. See, this prophet could look down here and see the nations will be judged. And then other prophets that followed him, they could see that short fulfillment. But the far-reaching fulfillment's over here. And they saw it through vision. And especially when we get to Daniel, you're going to see Daniel doing the same thing. We'll start studying Daniel in a couple of weeks. And Daniel gives us the whole history of the human race, all the way down in terms of governments and nations and what's going to happen. And that the Lord's going to be, he's going to bring a government to bear upon the earth. And that's over here, right here. Okay. Get excited about that. It's so clear. And so that's where we head. That's the chapters right there. Chapters 1 through 23, all about Judah falling and the promise of coming back. And then here you have the judgment of the nations all around. In fact, the nations are mentioned. I pull this right out of the quarterly because that's their introduction. The nations that are mentioned there is God's judgment on Ammon, Moab, Edom, and Philistia. Then we finally get to Tyre, then Egypt. I think that's all, most all of them. Those surrounding nations around Israel in that biblical time. All right, so Philistia is the sea peoples, the Phoenicians. The Phoenicians were, that's Tyre. We're going to be studying about Tyre today, the city of Tyre. I don't have a map. Maybe show a map over here. There's Tyre right here. There it is. Here's Jerusalem down here. Tyre's right here. On the Mediterranean Sea. And they were the Greek sea peoples later on. And the Phoenicians had many, many, many ships. And so quite a bit of time is spent today in the lesson about Tyre. Tyre, T-Y-R-E. Not only the city, which was quite a fortress because it went out from the land, it jetted out into the sea on sort of like an island. And they built an empire there, an empire, and one of the greatest empires. And Ezekiel is saying, well, the city will be destroyed. And Nebuchadnezzar did take them and put a siege around Tyre. after the fall of Jerusalem in 586 B.C., in 587, for several years, he besieged Tyre, Nebuchadnezzar did, and destroyed it except for the part out in the ocean. And then it took Alexander the Great later on that came, and he built a complete, you know, road out there. He built up fortifications and went all the way out to reach that city out in the ocean, seat where that king was seated. There's been many different kings. And he talks about in the lesson today the prince of the city, the prince of Tyre. And then there's a major shift, which we're going to see, a major shift from him talking about the prince to the king of Tyre. And so verses 1 through 10 is the prince, and then verses 11 through 19 is the king. The difference is the prince was a normal ruler, and he's being judged, and those who will follow him, like Tyre, the city was being judged, and the rulers were being judged because of their arrogance, and that's the reason, because of their arrogance. We're going to look into that too, about pride. But then behind the scenes, and this is what we have to understand, behind the scenes, there's a king who is behind these princesses. And that king is Lucifer. And so you have a reference for the first time in Scripture to the fall of Lucifer. And so you have to understand, and I know there's so much that we have to try to cover, but I hope you understand that. And I'm going to move on into something now. I've already introduced this shift, which means that in everything, even in your life, there is a spiritual or there's an unseen realm. There's an unseen realm. We all know that, right? Do we know that? An example would be Job. Remember what happened to Job? There were some unseen things that Job never knew. But when you start to read the book of Job, you see that there was something behind everything. All the suffering of Job, there was something behind it. There was something unseen, and we know that he was Satan. It was Satan. And then, the book of Revelation. In the book of Revelation, you have a scene in heaven, and then you have a corresponding events on the earth. Something takes place in heaven, and then it falls out to the earth. Something takes place up here, and then a judgment comes down here into the earth. And so there's the unseen realm. And of course, the unseen realm would be God himself, which you can't see, plus the fact that there's angels, which you cannot see. And of course, there's the fallen angels, which you cannot see. And so the fallen angels would include Satan and the demonic powers that be. And what we must learn is behind every form of government, there is the unseen realm. There's the unseen realm behind every form of government. It starts off with Babylon, and then the Greeks and the Medes and the Persians, and then the Greeks, and then the Romans, all the way through to even to now. Behind the United Nations are spirits and demonic forces that are moving the world toward a certain conclusion. And God allows certain things to be fulfilled in order to judge it. He will allow you to go your way in order for you to find out who is God. Are you God or is he God? And if you want your will done, there's a time when the Lord will step back and say, okay, you don't want my will, then your will be done. Jerome, I know you're hard-headed, but you got to bow the knee.
I can see the light.
That's right. But, you know, it's terrible when God steps back and tells Tommy Smith, okay, Tommy, go ahead and have it your way. You know, I remember old Frank Sinatra. Is that who he was? You know, remember him, that song he sang, I had it my way? I think old Elvis sang that song, I had it my way. You don't want it your way. You're going to wind up in hell having it your way. But God always lets these leaders, if they don't want to bow to Him, these leaders, He'll let them have it their way. And that'll be Satan's way. Because no man has his own will. No human being has his own will. You do not have your way. There's going to be something else pressing against you, pulling against you, pushing you. There's circumstances and there's powers behind those circumstances that drive human history. All right? And there's only two spirits. There's the Holy Spirit and there's the unholy spirit. Yes, Satan is the unholy spirit, but he has his minions, the demonic spirits, but they're all the unholy spirit. You have the Holy Spirit and the unholy spirit. And the unholy spirit has always promoted religion. The unholy spirit has always promoted religion. Here's what the Apostle Paul said of the pagan temple sacrifices in his day in Corinth. He said this, and this is in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 20. He says, the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. That was the sacrifices that was being carried out in Paul's day. Paul is saying they're sacrificing to demons. All right? That's why a lot of the early Christians wouldn't eat the meat sold in the marketplaces that had been sacrificed to demons. But what did Paul say? Paul says, sanctify it. Go ahead and buy it and sanctify it through prayer. Say, Lord, I pray that you'll sanctify this food to the use of my body. In Jesus' name, the demons are gone. There's no influence. You know, you need to pray over your food.
Yes.
Sanctify your food in the name of Jesus Christ. But anyway, that has to do with spiritual. That's unseen. All right? So, also, so in addition to Job illustrating the unseen realm, and the book of Revelation illustrating the unseen realm, we have the ministry of Jesus, which illustrates the unseen realm. If you didn't believe in the unseen, wait till you read the book of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. Everywhere Jesus went, what happened? Just about everywhere he went, what happened? Demons just came out everywhere. They were going crazy. It was stirred up. And one of them in the book of Mark said to Jesus, have you come here? We know who you are. Have you come here to torment us before the appointed time? They knew the appointed time. In Matthew 25:41, Jesus says that the lake of fire was prepared for the devil and his angels. So they knew the lake of fire was where they were going. Here's Jesus shows up. And they say, are you here to torment us before the time? And he told them to shut up and not talk. And sometimes he cast them out into swine. You remember the stories. And then there's one other example of the unseen realm. I just got excited about this morning. The Apostle Paul. Everywhere Paul went, the demon showed up. And remember the seven sons of Sceva? Or whatever his name was. They went around. They saw Jesus casting out devils and Paul casting out devils. So they decided they'd get in on the merchandise. Get in on the money.
Yeah.
You know, send me the money and God will bless you. So what they did was they went around and they found a man that was full of demons. And they said, in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, come out. And the demon said, we know Jesus,
but we
know Paul, but we don't know you. And what did they do? They jumped on those. They jumped on them and beat them up. Now, that person that was demon-possessed is the one who did the jumping and the beating. But, you know, if you're possessed by a demonic spirit, you can be violent. And there's records where people have had, you know, had four or five orderlies holding them down, and they couldn't even hold them because of the strength of the spirit that's in them. I know this is crazy. The world doesn't believe this. See, the world has no concept of unseen. The world has no concept of a spirit of God or the Holy Spirit of God or the nature of God himself. because no man at any time has seen God. You all right? So, having done that, I did all that to show you that there's something behind the prince. The prince of Tyre. The prince of Tyre. There's something behind him, and that behind him is called a king. The king of Tyre is behind him. All right, so let's go into that now. So we have Tyre's human ruler on the one hand over here, the human ruler. And then underneath, behind him, is the power of that human ruler's throne, the power of the throne. Is there a unseen supernatural power in Washington, D.C.? Absolutely. Absolutely. Was there a supernatural power behind Hitler? Absolutely. Because, you know, one of the designs of Satan from the very beginning was to destroy the Jew. Right? Because in Genesis 3:15, God said, the seed of the woman will crush your head. Talking about Satan. Talking to Satan. Yeah, I'll put enmity between you and the woman, and her seed will crush your head. Satan knew that. So when Adam and Eve had a child, that child was born, remember? And then Cain did what to that child?
Murdered it.
Because he was moved, we're told in the New Testament, that he was moved by a demonic spirit to kill it. Satan entered into it to kill that boy. All right? So what happens when Jesus is born? What happens when Moses is born, for that matter? They kill all the boy babies. Moses escapes. What happens when Jesus is born? We saw that last Sunday. Herod kills all the babies 2 years and under in Bethlehem. Why? Trying to get to the Messiah. All the way through. And then when Satan got him on the cross, he just jumped up and down. They had a party in hell. They thought they had something when they nailed Jesus to the cross. And it was God's plan all along to take that cross and pour the sins of the world upon Jesus there and let him suffer, separated from the Father and the Holy Spirit. My God, why have you forsaken me? And he was bearing our sins in his own body on the cross, on the tree. Cursed is he that hangeth upon a tree. Satan's always behind it. And what about the anti-Semitism even today on college campuses? Satan is a spirit of evil, because it's never God's plan to exterminate a people like that, especially the Jewish people. Okay, so, all right, verses 1 through 10 then, which is not in the quarterly today, but it's about the prince. Verses 1 through 10. There's a lot of things about that. I studied it, but we just don't have time to look at it. We could read it. Verses 1 through 10. Let's read it. I've got so much to say. Look in chapter 28. The word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus. All right, so remember now, this is the human ruler. Thus saith the Lord God, because your heart is lifted up. Now you see, the reason he's going to be judged is because of pride. All right. Because your heart has been lifted up, and you have said, I am a God. And here's this ruler saying, I'm God. Well, the Caesars all said they were God, remember? The Roman Caesars all claimed deity. Okay. So this is nothing new. I'm a God. Okay, fine. And he says, I sit in the seat of God in the midst of the seas. I've already pointed out, his kingdom was part out in the ocean. You know, some people would say that's Atlantis, and later it went on out into the ocean, whatever. He says, yet what is he? Is he a God? He says, yet you are a man and not God. Hey, that's pretty good. You put that on your mirror, you know. When I worked with teenage boys, because this was told me one time by one of our chaplains, he He said he used to get out of the shower every morning and point to the mirror and say, "You're the man." So these boys that I work with have such low self-esteem. They're beat up and they've been abused or whatever. I always tell them to do that. Some do it and some will say, "No, I don't do that." But I want to point in the mirror and say, "You're the man. Look, put it on the book. You're not, you're a man, all right? You're the man. You're the only man you have if you're a man. You're the man, but you're not God." And so he says, "You are a man and not God." That's pretty good. So it should be his will, not my will, right? You're a man, not God. Though you set your heart as the heart of God. Behold, you're wiser than Daniel. Now that's not true, but in other words, the question is, behold, sort of sarcastically, behold, you're wiser than Daniel, right? And there's nothing that's secret can be hid from you. Is that true? Aren't you so smart? You're wiser than Daniel, and nothing is hid from you. That's what he's saying. In verse 4, with thy wisdom and with thy understanding, you have gotten your riches. Now, he doesn't play down their wisdom. This man, this ruler, is very wise. And usually, if there's a great flourishing kingdom or government, you have somebody smart behind it. Not somebody like we got in Washington, D.C. Everything's going down. But when you have somebody coming up and there's a great empire, there's somebody smart behind it. And so he doesn't diminish that. He talks about their wisdom. And listen, incidentally, intelligence or wisdom, is God never puts that down. What he puts down is, it's right here. If you're handsome, Jim, if you're the handsomest guy in your class, God doesn't put that down. You're beautiful, you're handsome. But if it causes you to be proud and you think you're something greater than every other man, you done got up there around among the gods, then you're in trouble. He puts down this, and I put this up. This was a quote from Dr. Thomas Constable. He has a commentary on every single book in the whole Bible, 66 commentaries. This man's graduate, he's a professor at Dallas Seminary at one time. He's dead now. But he said this, probably more than anywhere else, Ezekiel 28 sets forth pride as the destroying sin. And we see it all the way through the scripture, pride, yes. And God resists the proud and gives what? He gives grace to the humble. God resists the proud, gives grace to the humble. And so we're going to see that the original sin in the universe is pride. Because when we get to this king over here, that's going to be his problem too. Because he was beautiful, because he was wise, and all the things that go with it, all of his beauty, his function, his position that God gave him. We're talking about Lucifer now. His sin was pride. He lifted up himself in pride and in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 14, the five I wills. I will arise. I will go. I will lift up myself above the clouds of God, above the stars of God, above the throne of God. See, his the five I wills of Satan. I hope we get to that. But anyway, let's read on. Okay, so I'm not going to read on that part. You see the point. That's his heart's lifted up in pride. And so God says in verse 8, I'll bring you down. And in verse 9, will you say, I love this verse 9. In other words, he said he was a god, and God said, I'm going to bring you down. I'm going to let people come over there and invade your land, and they're going to destroy you and your city. In verse 9, he says, now, look at that, verse 9. It says, will you yet say before him that slayeth you, I'm God? In other words, here's somebody getting ready with a sword to take his life. They done run over his city. They come in there, they're going to kill him. And the scripture says, now, the guy's about to slay you. Are you going to say to him, wait a minute, I'm God? And that's what it says in verse 9. Will you yet say, before him that slayeth you, I am God? No, God says, but you are a man. You shall be a man. You are a man. And you know, you're no God in the hand of him that slayeth you. In the hand of him that slayeth you, you know, that kills you, you're not a God. You are a man, and you'll die like a man. All right, so that's the point. This prince is what? He is a man. Y'all get that? That's simple. He is a man. But when we get to this over here, verses 11 to 19, this dude's not a man. This is the unseen realm. This dude is not a man. He is a what? Anybody redhead? What is he? He's a cherub. He's a cherub. A cherub is the highest ranking angel that God made. There are cherubim, which are the plural for cherub. There are cherubim, there's the seraphim, and then there's the other angels, you know, the run of angels. There's different ranking angels. Some of them are named like Gabriel or Michael. And also Lucifer is named. Okay, so there it is. Now, look at verse 11. Let's go into that real quick. This is going to be, the lesson was today was verses 11 through 19 plus 25 through 26. So look at verse 11. He says, now see there in verse 11, there's a change of paragraph. He says, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me saying. So that's a break. We're not talking about the prince anymore. We're talking about something else. And he says, son of man, that's the title for Ezekiel, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus. Now we're talking about not the prince, but the king. And the prince is a man. He dies like a man. The king is a cherub. He's not a man. All right? And so he says, take a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus and say unto him, thus saith the Lord God, you sealeth up the sun, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. All right? This is when he was created. We're going to see that in a moment. When God created this creature, he sealed up, meaning he was the fullest extent of beauty, the fullest extent of wisdom, full of the sum of all the perfections, perfect in beauty. This is not a two-horned little guy with a pointed tail. You know, that's what the world would like for us to think of. That's a little fairy tale stuff. Oh, no. This is something else. And then verse 13. You have been in Eden, the garden of God. Now, that's not the garden of Eden where Adam and Eve was on the earth. But that's the garden of Eden. That's the Eden of God. That's the abode of God somewhere else. Because it's going to be described far different than Adam and Eve's garden. Look at it. Every precious stone was your covering. The sardis, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes were prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Now, so God has created something. It's absolutely beautiful. And his prep, the word pipes there has to do with his ability to make sound, you know, the beautiful sound, his voice. Verse 14, thou art the what? You are what? You are the anointed cherub that covers. All right, is he a man? We're talking about the unseen realm. Behind this, every evil, every kind of government on earth, there's an unseen realm. You're the anointed cherub that covers. Covereth there, this idea is that guarding something, standing guard. What comes to mind is in the Holy of Holies, there was the Ark of the Covenant, remember that? And then there was the mercy seat, which is golden overlaid right there on top of the Ark of the Covenant. And then there was these cherub with their big wings, and they were looking, you know, this is my drawing of them, they were looking down like that over this mercy seat. And when the high priest would come in once a year for the Day of Atonement, he would come in and he would sprinkle the blood right there. And God had said, that's where I'll meet you. I won't meet you any other place except right there at the blood. In other words, in our day, I won't meet you anywhere until you come to the cross. Because the cross is where Christ suffered and shed his blood. And so these cherub were hovering over this, looking down. They represented the holiness or the righteousness, the justice of God. All the characteristics of God they were representing and displaying that, illustrating that right there. So that's what comes to mind when it says, you're the anointed cherub which covereth. All right, we see that. And he says, and I have set you so. God put him there in that position. You were, thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou, you walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. I have a reference there for that one. That refers to the stones of fire describe an abode as well as divine entities in that abode. Professor Clifford cited by Heiser. So the stones of fire there, it's not just stones on fire. It represents the place of abode and those entities that dwell there. So we're talking about a description of something far beyond what we can comprehend. But it's been described in many different places in Scripture. The book of Revelation describes similar places, you know, where God, this is the abode of God, or these gods. You understand that there was divine beings. They were divine. They were not God. There's only one God. But there are divine beings. They're divine beings. And Satan was a divine being. In fact, he's called gods, a god. And it's in Psalm 82, I believe, or 83. The divine council was made up of these divine beings, and they were responsible for the universe. And so Satan was responsible for some stuff. And so, again, we've got something. See, Adam in the Garden of Eden wasn't walking among these things, was he? He had not been in these. It's not about Adam. But a lot of the theologians say this is a reference to Adam. You know, he was innocent, then he fell. Adam did fall. But Adam was never a cherub, and he was never any of these things don't apply to Adam. Couldn't possibly be. In verse 15, it says, "Thou, you," or I'm reading it from the Authorized Version, O King James, "thou wast perfect in the ways, in your ways from the day that you were created." Notice that, perfect. And so it's not a man. Perfect in the days that you were, until the days you were created, till iniquity was found in you. Now, iniquity was found. All right? And we'll see what that was. Verse 16, "By the multitudes of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore, what's the result? I will cast you down. I will cast you as profane out of the mountain of God. And I will destroy you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire," you know, out from the other divine beings, I'm casting you down. The other divine beings, they will see it. You see, there are other divine beings, just like Lucifer, except they're not fallen. And they see this. There are angels right now looking on the earth, the elect. There's elect angels and there's fallen angels. And both are very concerned with what's happening in the human race. Because the human race is resolving the angelic conflict. It started in Genesis 3:15. He, the seed of the woman, will bruise your head. You know, you will crush his crowned head. And then it says of Satan, or his seed, and he will bruise his heel. Well, on the cross, you know, Satan did what he could do, but he was defeated there. He didn't realize how God had planned the cross to be his downfall. Verse 17, your heart was lifted up. Here it is, the sin. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You have corrupted your wisdom by reason of your brightness. He says, and I will cast you to the ground. The word there is eretz, and it's the word for the earth or the underground. The earth or the underground. I'll cast you down to the earth or to the underground, and I will lay you before kings, that they might behold you. These are divine beings. These aren't human kings. Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of your iniquities, by the iniquity of your traffic. That's what he was doing. Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of thee, and it shall devour thee. I remember when I wrote my book, the book that I wrote, I'm trying to remember the title of The War of the Lords. The War of the Lords is the title of the book. And when I got to this part, you see, God put in Satan, when he fell, a consuming lust. There it is right there. He put in the midst of him a fire that will devour him. And in a sense, humans have that too, because of the fall. Without God, people are driven. Something inside them drives them to their own destruction. And so God put in Satan a fire that drives him, that will ultimately devour him. He's never satisfied. You know, if as smart as Satan is, and he's very smart, because he's the smartest thing that ever walked, he knows the scripture. Remember when he tempted Jesus? He quoted scripture to Jesus. Imagine that, quoting scripture to Jesus. But Satan knew the scripture, and if he knows the scripture, he also knows about the lake of fire, doesn't he? He knows where he's going. Even those demons that I quoted earlier, they knew where they were going. They said, are you here to send us here before the time appointed? And yet, even though he knows where he's going, he drives on. He's burning. His desire is to go against God, to accomplish himself above God, to rise above God. He still thinks he can do it, even though he knows God's word. Folks, there's a lot of people who know God's word. There's a lot of people who are lost, and they're going to hell because they believe that they can do good and that God will accept them for what they are, because they're smart, because they've accomplished different things. And they will look at other people and they say, well, you know, I'd never be like that, and God will be pleased with me. And they know the scripture, but they still go right on in their self-righteousness. You know, it's a horrible thing to believe in your own self-righteousness. And see, that's what religion is. And you know, we have to say this, that Western Church, and we're Western Church, the Western Church, you know, when the third world churches and the Eastern people look at us, they look at us like the rich young ruler, you know, who thinks he's got it made. You know, I have need of nothing. I'm not blind. I can see. When we're blind and we're poor, although we think we're rich and we can see. Jesus said that. Remember in Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3? But he put a fire in him, in the midst of him, to devour him. And he says, and I will bring you to ashes upon the earth. Again, eretz, which means the earth or underneath the earth, in the sight of all of them that behold thee. Although they that know you among the people shall be astonished at you, you shall be a terror. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shall thou be any more. So it's going to be, there's an end to it. All right, that's that much. Okay, we got a little time. Now, let me say a few things in wrapping that up before we go to verse 24 and 25. This passage, 11 through 19, right here, about this cherub, reaches beyond the human ruler to the spiritual power in that ruler, energizing that ruler and his government. Like Hitler had an energizing spirit within him. You would understand that. Hitler had a lot more than just mental illness, if he had mental illness. There's mental illness on the one hand, yes, true. It's part of the fall of man. If you know anybody that really has mental illness, it's the fall of man. If somebody has leukemia, it's the fall of man. If anything you've inherited, it's just the fall of man. You know, you can't blame somebody if they got leukemia. You know, or type 1 diabetes. You can blame the type 2 people, but not the type 1. But the point is, I forgot the point. It'll come back to me, maybe. Yeah, the point is that there's energizing spirit toward moving toward evil things sometimes. The Bible says in Philippians, Paul said, God is in you. Here we go. God is in you, both to will and to do his good pleasure. So we see there's an energizing spirit of God in you, causing you to will something. What are you willing? You're willing the good pleasure of God. I said last week, and I'll say it again, I've said it many times, the number one evidence that you are a child of God is that you desire the Word of God. If a person's not desiring the Word of God, there's no evidence of spiritual life. Sorry, it's true. As a baby desires the milk of the mother, when we're born again of the Spirit of God, we'll desire God's Word. In fact, it's God's Word that gives us that new birth. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And then we're going to continue to feed on that Word of God. And then the second quality or evidence that somebody's saved is that they love the children of God. Over and over the scripture says, and Paul uses the phrase too, he says, I've heard about your love of the brethren. Do you love the people of God? Do you love the Word of God? Do you love to be around the people of God, fellowship? Do you love the Word of God? Do you love the fellowship in the Word of God? If so, that's a good indication that you're saved. You say, oh no, I know I'm saved. I got a church membership. Well, that means nothing. That means nothing. You know, you can join the Rotary Club and call that salvation. Do you love the Word of God? Do you love the people of God? Those are two biblical illustrations. The love of God in you. Do you love God? The love of God. Okay, now. So, Satan and his demons, the world rulers of this present, Paul called it the world rulers of this present darkness. The scripture makes it clear that demonic forces are the real rulers of the world. Ephesians 6:12, Daniel chapter 10, verses 10 through 21, where Satan, the devil, as the chief ruler, or he's the king of this world, he's called the god of this age. John 12:31, John 14:30, John 16:11, 2 Corinthians 4:4. Paul calls Satan the god of this world. Yeah, so we need to see that. Satan, then, is the real power behind the throne, behind anybody's throne, of both ancient and future Tyre. It's important to see that we got, you know, here's the thing, we got Tyre, and also you have another place in Scripture is Isaiah 14, verses 12 through 14. It's a parallel passage where you have this king of Babylon, and he's talking about Satan. And over here you have this king of Tyre, and we're talking about Satan. And so we could look at that passage in Isaiah, if you'll just turn there just a moment. These are the two passages that we have that helps us see the origin of Satan or the sin of Satan, okay? It's going to be Isaiah 14. Let me find it. Here we go. Isaiah 14. And you've heard of the, what's called the five I wills, or the five wills of Satan. Look at chapter 14 and beginning in verse 12. All right? Everybody look at it. The question is, keep in mind, in Isaiah 14, he's talking about the same thing here. He's talking about a human ruler and somebody behind him. And it gets mixed up, see, okay? But there's a human ruler there in Babylon, and there's a unseen ruler, okay? So here he's talking about the unseen one in Babylon. He says, how are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? How are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? It's not talking about a man, is it? There's no man that's ever been in heaven. Son of the morning, how are you cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in your heart, all right, here's the sin of Lucifer, and this is the original sin in the human, in the universe. The original sin in the universe among divine beings, which was also brought down to the earth to Adam and Eve. What does he say? Look at verse 13. For you have said in your heart, what?
There is no God.
No. You have said in his heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. That's divine beings. There's angels, stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds, and I will be like the Most High. Those are the five I wills. That's the fall of Satan right there. How art thou fallen, O Lucifer? Now, if he shows up on earth, when God made Adam and Eve, it's a beautiful place, perfect environment, wonderful people, Adam and Eve. And what does he say to the woman? If you'll do this, you will be like
God.
You'll be like God. You see, Satan wants to be like God. He says, I will be like the Most High. Just read it. I will be like the Most High. And so he promises that to Eve, too. You'll be like God if you'll do this. You're gonna know good and evil. Your eyes will be open. You're no longer, you're blind right now, but your eyes will get open. You know, just take this drug and you'll be more intelligent. A lot of people fell for that one. They still do fall for that one. You know, you make better on tests if you just take these drugs. Well, you do for a while, I guess. I don't know. I never did take them. Satan then is portrayed here in his fallen, unfallen state in this passage together with Isaiah 14 verses 12 through 14 gives the entrance of sin into a sinless universe and Satan's fall. What I just read is from Unger's Bible Handbook, page 375. Dr. Unger relates Isaiah 14 with Ezekiel 28 as the fall of Satan, okay? And so does a lot of others. Now, a lot of people don't believe this because they don't believe in the unseen or they don't believe in the supernatural. So they got to explain everything away, like they explain creation away, you know, the whole thing. All right, let's go. We got one more thing real quick. Verses 25 through 26, and I probably should have spent more time on this, but here in verse 25, through 26, he says, thus saith the Lord God, when I shall have gathered the house of Israel from the people among whom they are scattered, and shall be sanctified in them in the sight of the heathen, then shall they dwell in their land, and I have given to my servant Jacob, and they shall dwell safely therein, and shall build houses and plant vineyards, yea, they shall dwell with confidence when I have executed judgments upon all those that despise them round about them, and they shall know that I am the Lord God. All right, so when does that happen? It happens, I'm trying to figure out where. It happens over here. Here's the nations all around them.
They're going to be judged. Even the Jews are judged here. And he's going to gather up all from around Old Testament. All the Old Testament saints will be resurrected right here. That's when the resurrection of all Old Testament saints takes place. And so even in the times of Jesus, that's still part of Old Testament saints. The body of Christ is not resurrected there. The body of Christ is resurrected here at the rapture. The rapture takes place right here. That's the rapture. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. The second advent is when God gathers all his children, Old Testament saints. They're going to make up Israel. They make up Israel. And all Israel will be saved right here. And they will go into the millennium in resurrected bodies, except for those who are still living coming out of the tribulation. They go as mortals into the millennium, and they will have children. Okay, that's it. I know that that's hard. It's so much that I leave unsaid. Please don't judge me for anything incomplete, because there's so much that I leave undone. But I hope this will help you begin to think about it. And again, if read all the way through the scripture concerning that last point, all the way through scripture, these prophets saw the gathering of God's people again going into a paradise. Paradise regained. Over here, paradise lost, paradise regained right here. And all God's people go into that. It's not heaven. That's the kingdom of God on the earth. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your grace. We pray as we enter into the worship service this morning, you'll open our mind and our heart. Draw us to your word. May God the Holy Spirit enlighten us, give us understanding. The eyes of our understanding being enlightened. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.